Welcome to a new season of Asian American Life. I'm your host, Ernabel Demillo. This month marks the 20th anniversary of September 11th, a day we'll never forget. On this show, we'll pay tribute to one of the 9/11 heroes, a former Port Authority canine officer who miraculously walked away after being buried underneath the rubble. Plus, we'll take a look at how Asian American communities are protecting themselves as the rise of anti-Asian hate continues.
Also on the show, Bold and Beautiful, celebrating timeless and ageless beauty of seniors. Plus, YA, young adult authors are changing the narrative. This and more on Asian American Life.
20 years ago, I met David Lim, at the time a Port Authority canine police officer who miraculously survived the collapse of the North Tower. We've kept in touch via social media and reunited recently to reflect on that day, September 11th, 20 years later.
I was at my daughter's recital in school, and she was first clarinet and playing the solo of Bolero. And I remember her playing, and my wife said, "Why are you crying?" She says, "Because there, but for the grace of God, I wouldn't be here listening to this." It was beautiful to hear. I mean, it was those little things, you know, that I now appreciate.
David Lim was one of only 16 who survived the collapse of the North Tower.
I was a canine officer, was assigned to the World Trade Center with the Port Authority Police.
On that fateful day, he and his partner Cirrus, a golden lab, had just finished checking trucks for bombs and explosives.
So we're sitting there, and all of a sudden, I feel the building shake, right? You have to remember, I'm in the basement of two World Trade Center. I hear on the radio there's an explosion on the upper levels of one World Trade. So my first thought was, I turn around to Cirrus and says, "Oh my God, one must have got by us. Something on a truck got in and they got upstairs." And I said, "Listen, you stay here. I'm gonna go help the people in the other building, and I'll come back and get you."
But Lim never had the opportunity to go back. As he was helping people evacuate the North Tower, the unthinkable happened.
My best description, it was like a hurricane because of the wind as was pancaking and the floors all the way down. I could hear it as it was coming.
Lim had been running down the stairwell when he stopped to help Josephine Harris, a Port Authority employee who was having trouble. That decision saved his life.
I grabbed Josephine, and firefighter Billy Butler grabbed the other side, and we started taking her down. I remember Captain Mazza turning around and saying, "Davey, leave her with the firemen, go out with us," you know. And I was like, "Well, I already have her, you know, I'm right behind you."
Seconds later, 110 floors of concrete and steel collapsed around them. Lim, along with 12 firefighters and three civilians, including Harris, were in a pocket of the tower that stayed intact. They were dubbed the survivors of Stairwell B. I met Lim 20 years ago when he first told me his story when I worked at Fox 5. Today, we meet again at the dog park dedicated to his former partner, Cirrus, who died in the terrorist attack.
A lot of people like, for some reason, use the expression that, you know, God saved you for another purpose, that you're special in that regard. And my answer is, I'm no more special than those other 3,000 people that were killed.
After the tragedy, Lim was lauded for his heroism. He's still a hero today. Two young PAPD officers stopped by excited to meet him. The self-described introvert found himself thrust into the spotlight after 9/11.
Our heroes will now open the marketplace.
I remember my sergeant told me, he said, "Listen, Dave, I have 1,000 men out there digging, but I only have you, right, and a few other people to go out and tell the story about what happened and represent our department. So I'm asking you to do this."
So I have to speak now for those who can no longer speak. I guess that's where it lies heaviest for me.
I have a unique perspective in that not only am I a police officer that survived the collapse, but I'm an Asian police officer that survived. And I feel sort of responsibility to be a good role model, you know, to let people know that, you know, that if you want to be a police officer, what we call, you know, as an Asian, and it's an honorable profession.
Lim was born in Chinatown and grew up in Far Rockaway, Queens, where his parents owned a takeout restaurant. It was there his career came calling.
A lot of police officers would come to, you know, pick up their meals, and they would talk to me and my brother about their stories, about what they do. And I discovered that it wasn't so much like what you see on TV with, you know, cops shooting bad guys. It was more about helping people, you know, people that are hurt, people in accidents, stuff like that, CPR, things like that. So I felt that that would be a good profession for me to follow into.
Lim retired in 2014. Today, he and his wife, who are big Met fans, hope to continue their pre-COVID travels visiting ballparks across the country, all the while counting his blessings.
This thing taught me to appreciate the little things in life, but it also taught me not to sweat the little things in life. Like when something bad happens and, you know, you go, well, nothing can be that bad compared to what I went through, you know, and it's carried me through for these last 20 years.
I'm Ernabel Demillo for Asian American Life.
The New York City primary elections in June yielded a record number of Asian Americans who won Democratic City Council primaries. Right now, there are two Asian American New York City Council members, Peter Ku representing Queens District 20 and Margaret Chin representing Manhattan's District 1. Both will be stepping down because of term limits. That number could triple if all six of the Asian American primary winners are victorious in November's general elections. In District 20, which includes Flushing and Murray Hill, attorney Sandra Ong, who was born in Cambodia and raised in Taiwan but has called Flushing home nearly all her life, will be the Democratic candidate well-positioned to succeed Peter Ku. In nearby Queens District 23, which includes Bayside, Fresh Meadows, and Queens Village, nonprofit leader Linda Lee made history as the first woman and person of color who would hold a District 23 City Council seat. She is joined by Julie Wan, who clinched the nomination to represent District 26, covering Astoria and Long Island City, to become the two first Korean Americans to serve on the New York City Council. South Asians are also showing their political muscle. In Queens District 25, which covers Jackson Heights and Elmhurst, Indian American community activist and civil rights lawyer Shekhar Krishnan is positioned to become the first South Asian to be elected to the New York City Council, together with Shahana Hanif, a Bangladeshi immigrant and community organizer who won Brooklyn's 39th District City Council primary. A third South Asian, Indo-Caribbean teacher Felicia Singh, is looking to flip District 32 in southeastern Queens. Currently, it is the last Republican-held district in Queens. Kyung Yoon, Asian American Life.
Anti-Asian hate may be out of the news cycle, but Asian Americans continue to experience verbal and physical assaults. Ad hoc groups around the country like New York City's Chinatown Block Watch have popped up to stand up against anti-Asian hate and show strength in community. When anti-Asian hate began to spike in New York City in early 2020, lifelong Chinatown resident Karlin Chan sprung into action. He started the Chinatown Mural Project to attract more foot traffic into his neighborhood.
We're calling this Art for Recovery when we started this last August.
And as part of his recovery efforts, Chan also started the Chinatown Block Watch, calling on his friends and neighbors to change the narrative from fear to community building while helping residents feel safe on the streets.
Always people pushing their own narrative. So that gets kind of stretched into, if you're Chinese, you step out into the street, you're gonna get attacked. So that's why I created the Chinatown Block Watch.
For more than 18 months, the Chinatown Block Watch has been patrolling the neighborhood with a growing number of volunteers.
People know if you harbor any racist attitudes towards the Asians or towards the Chinese, that kind of behavior is not welcome in this neighborhood. But we won't hesitate to call the police.
Yeah.
Right? We're not there as a bunch of vigilantes. We're not there to apprehend people. But you know, you never know how you're going to react. If I see someone being attacked physically, yes, I'm going to intervene.
The Chinatown Block Watch is just one of many groups across the country responding to the rise in anti-Asian hate. In Oakland, California, volunteers comb through the city's Chinatown. In San Jose, California, Japantown has its own volunteer patrol unit. New York City's Chinatown Block Watch has attracted volunteers like Sylvia Ang, a mother of two.
When I first heard about all the little crimes here and there in Chinatown, it makes people scared to go out. It made me scared to go out. Even just simple errands like going to do grocery. So when the group was formed, I thought it was a brilliant idea. Why not we all go out and just keep an eye on each other? Even just walking around the neighborhood, getting people acknowledge who we are, that letting them know that, hey, when you know the uniforms, police enforcement are not around, we are here to keeping an eye to our community for safety.
It shows people that there's somebody that cares, and we're not afraid to come out. We're not afraid to, you know, be a presence, put our boots on the ground, and just be around so people can, you know, feel a little bit more comfortable.
According to Stop AAPI Hate's latest report, Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders are experiencing unprecedented mental health issues. Asian Americans who have experienced racism are more stressed by anti-Asian hate than the pandemic itself.
There's a history, I guess, with Asians of not going to the cops, not reporting crimes, not making a fuss. And I think that even just us being on the street, we're raising the awareness. And maybe something happens, we can give somebody the courage to speak up, to advocate for themselves.
It's good to report these goods, you know, or even record them and throw them out on social media platforms like Twitter, yeah. Instagram, just to call these races out. So it may discourage other people from acting out.
As New York City continues to reopen, Chan is encouraged by what the group has observed in the last few months.
We're seeing the beginnings of the phoenix rise from the ashes again. If you walk around the neighborhood, you'll see many more people. The tour groups are back. We also see empty storefronts being renovated. So far this year, the Ox is, so far it's been a much better year than year that rat.
New York City's Chinatown Block Watch continues to patrol on Thursdays and Sundays. They welcome new volunteers. For Asian American Life, I'm Rayner Ramirez. On Asian American History this month. The history of anti-Asian hate began soon after the first Chinese immigrant settled in the United States to build the Transcontinental Railroad in the mid-19th century. The Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882 fomented xenophobia. On September 2, 1885, a mob of 150 angry white miners terrorized a Chinese community in Rock Springs, Wyoming. Chinese miners were beaten, scalped, dismembered, and burned alive. 28 Chinese miners were killed, 15 wounded. 16 men were arrested for the killings and then released to a cheering crowd. No one was ever convicted.
I'm Minnie Roh. Over the past year, we have heard heartbreaking stories of Asian seniors being victimized by hate crimes and often branded as vulnerable and helpless. But as two Chinese American women have proven with their photography project turned book called Chinatown Pretty, these senior citizens are anything but that. Using fashion as a lens, we learn about the lives of these elders who are undoubtedly the heartbeat of the neighborhood.
Head to any Chinatown in North America and you'll most likely come across a sight of elderly residents dressed in the most unique blend of colors and patterns that defy conventional fashion rules. The results are outfits befitting a trend-setting urban hipster, but they also tell a deeper story of their diaspora, their values, and culture.
There is a real flair for color and pattern and textures. A lot of the clothes are gifted or hand-me-downs or handmade.
Photographer Andria Lowe said she and her friend turned writing partner Valerie Liu would frequently meet in Chinatown to eat dim sum and people watch. Lowe says they began to wonder about the fashion stylings of the popos and gunggungs, or grandma and grandpas, and the story behind what Lowe calls their unintentionally intentional clothing choices.
This project was also a way we could connect with our grandparents' generation. We saw a lot of our grandparents in the seniors out and about.
Over the span of 7 years, they approached seniors with Lowe's favorite pickup line,
which is Popo Holang, and basically it means, Grandma, you look good.
The two authors used fashion to delve into the story of their lives and how it influenced their one-of-a-kind outfits. Joyce Wing makes her own clothes, the Mandarin collar a nod to her Hong Kong roots, while the tailored lines reveal her skill as a seamstress upon immigrating to the U.S.
A lot of the women that we meet, like my grandparents and like Valerie's grandma as well, they worked as seamstresses in factories because that was really one of the only jobs they could get without knowing a lot of English.
Mrs. Yi paired a bright orange cap, plaid upon plaid, including this Madras blazer, which she said her daughter gave her as she left for college.
They're saving, they're reusing, they're recycling. And we like to say that they're, you know, a lot of the fashion we see is on the, you know, it's more sustainable, but they're not doing it, you know, to earn green points there. That's just kind of how they live.
But for the most part, the fashion choices are driven by function.
They're always trying to keep the sun out, you know, so they wear these big bonnet hats, really wide brim visors, sometimes even gloves. They're also trying to keep warm, especially in San Francisco Bay Area. There's tons of foggy days. They've been through so much. A lot of them have been through war, through family separation. They've started over in a new country without speaking the language. So they're very resilient. And this book is definitely a collection of stories about their resiliency and the strength.
Especially during the pandemic, when Chinatowns nationwide suffered crippling economic hardships and incidents of anti-Asian hate. The authors say this book is a celebration of this community that has persevered.
We've heard from a lot of people throughout the last year that this book has brought them a lot of joy, especially in these times where, you know, the news can be really dark. And people have said, you know, thank you for doing this project, for releasing this book. We will just pick up the book and we'll open it to any page just to, you know, brighten our day a little bit. And we're really proud and happy to be able to share these stories to, you know, offer more of a connection to this group of people that, you know, often gets overlooked, or we don't see too much in the media, or we don't see too much in books.
Mostly, Lowe says she hopes Chinatown Pretty will encourage people everywhere to connect with their senior neighbors. She quotes her favorite interview with a New York City Chinatown man, only identified as the extra stitch.
The sunset is infinitely beautiful, but it signals the end of the day. One day you'll be old as well. We took that proverb to mean basically the golden rule, treat other people as you want to be treated, and acknowledging a demographic that I think often can be a bit invisible. I think that's what we took that to mean is, yeah, treat seniors how you want to be treated as well.
Chinatown Pretty also illustrates that everyone has a great story. Lowe says if you pause long enough to connect with people, you'll find that life's struggles and its rewards are the same across all communities. And perhaps from there, stereotypes can be broken. I'm Minnie Roh for Asian American Life.
In September 1965, Filipino farm workers in Delano, California walked off the grape fields. They were fighting for better wages and conditions. What they didn't realize was they were making history setting in motion one of the biggest strikes in California labor history. The Delano Grape Strike led to the creation of the United Farm Workers and made union leader Cesar Chavez a household name. But two men almost faded into history, Larry Itliong and Philip Veracruz, key leaders who led the initial strike. 2 weeks into the Filipino farmers' walkout, Itliong, a labor organizer, convinced Mexican labor leaders Chavez and Dolores Huerta to join the strike because the white farmers were pitting the workers along ethnic lines. Itliong knew a united front would have more impact. The strike lasted a long 5 years, finally settled after a consumer grape boycott. It was a victory for the farm workers. For the Filipino labor leaders, it has been a long journey for justice. Only recently have they been recognized for their efforts. And many credit Marissa Arroyo's 2014 documentary, The Delano Manongs, for putting a spotlight on their story. Today, October 25th, is celebrated as Larry Itliong Day in California. There is Itliong Veracruz Middle School. There is the children's book published by the late historian Don Mabalon and writer Gail Romasanta. And this summer, the Delano City Council announced they will name a park in Itliong's honor, helping to see the Filipino leader's place in American history. I'm Ernabel Demillo for Asian American Life.
I'm Kyung Yoon. I've been a reader all my life, but growing up in America, I honestly don't recall a single book from my childhood or teen years that had a main character who looked like me. But thankfully, all that's changing. In recent years, we're seeing more Asian American stories in young adult novels.
My newly found level of social acceptance and the potential for a real-life girlfriend.
Ed Lin is reading from his novel, David Tung Can't Have a Girlfriend Until He Gets Into an Ivy League College. The title of this young adult novel, which was published last fall, captures a familiar coming-of-age story from an unfamiliar point of view. A Chinese-American teenage boy in New Jersey who wrestles with fitting in at school, keeping his grades up, and trying to please his immigrant parents who run a Chinese restaurant.
Thinking about how it was for me, with high academic expectations from the parents, and also working at the family business as well. David's family business is a restaurant. Ours was a hotel. It's a 24/7 business. I just started thinking about if my childhood were a YA novel, like my time in high school, it would totally be Ed Lin Can't Have a Girlfriend Until He Gets Into an Ivy League College. That would totally been it.
Fortunately for his social life, not to mention fans of Lin's mystery novels set in New York City's Chinatown and Taipei, Ed made his way to Columbia University, where he majored in engineering, he says to please his parents, but he also studied literature writing. David Tung is his first young adult novel.
I feel like I'm really getting to this group of certain Asian Americans who grew up like I did, and you know, just maybe they'll see themselves represented. I used to not believe that you needed to see representation in order to do something, right? But then, you know, when Jeremy Lin just broke out as a star and I saw that guy playing and I saw that guy doing the dunks, I was like, I can fly. I wish I saw that when I was a kid. I mean, not that I would have been a ball player, but I would have felt more confident in overcoming things.
You're my best friend, Ellen, Jesse says in the dark. I would have never survived this year without you.
Marie Myung-Ok Lee also drew on her personal experiences as a child of Korean immigrants growing up in an all-white town in the Midwest to create the character of Ellen Sung in her groundbreaking young adult novel, Finding My Voice.
I think a lot of people do this for their first novels. I think James Baldwin talked about how first novels are all autobiographical because you have so much stuff you have to get off your chest.
Marsha Randall suddenly comes up to me and shoves me hard on the shoulder. Hey, I say.
For Lee, this meant writing about bullying and violence that Ellen faces from her peers for being a different race. Finding My Voice was first published in 1992. Coincidentally, it was reissued again in 2021 at a time that incidents of anti-Asian violence have surged in the United States in the wake of COVID.
Not that it's wonderful that there's been all this violence, but it just sort of, you know, what has been a big bugaboo for me in the media is like, oh, Asian Americans suddenly getting angry about violence. I'm like, no, we're not suddenly angry about it. We've been talking about this all this time and no one has been listening.
Lee is the author of several more young adult books that center Asian American voices and characters and is at work on her next YA novel, which is a retelling of Steinbeck's Of Mice and Men, set in a Korean cram school. Marie Myung-Ok Lee and Ed Lin are at the forefront of a movement of Asian American authors who are finding and using their voices. I'm Kyung Yoon for Asian American Life.
That's our show for now. If you want to learn more about these stories, be sure to follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and TikTok at Asian American Life. I'm Ernabel Demillo. We'll see you next time.